So thank you all for coming. Just a little bit about our agenda. We're going to do, we've already gone through the first agenda. I don't need to realize that's what you were doing while you were drinking and talking. But a little bit of networking. We're going to go through some brief introductions about what mobile content is, then look at some upcoming events, and then we'll have our wonderful presentation. By the way, my name is Jason Grigsby. One of the organizers of Mobile Portland. Mobile Portland is a nonprofit organization here in Portland. We meet on the fourth Monday of every month. How many of you is this your first Mobile Portland meeting? Please raise your hand. All right. It's about half every time. It's really great. You should come next time, and maybe we can have three quarters of people who are here repeatedly. We talk about mobile topics, and it just varies based on whatever topic seems apt that month. We try to have one per quarter that's technical, one that's say business marketing, sort of social, and or business marketing, entrepreneurship, that sort of stuff, and then one that's social. So sometimes we talk about like last summer we had somebody from Sustainable Harvest talking about how people are using mobile devices in coffee fields. It was really, really fascinating. We had somebody talking about mobile in education and how Canby School District was working. But then we also have talks like, hey, this is how you develop things for Windows 8, and this is what's coming out. Or, like today, a fantastic talk about all the crazy ways in which Patrick has been advertising these apps. There are a few other things. We have a website, mobileportland.com, a Google group that you should go to. There are two mailing lists. There's one mailing list on mobileportland.com that is essentially just for announcements. So you receive two emails per month, one announcing the event, a second one reminding you of the event, and a third one on occasion if I screw up the email or the address of the facility. So those of you this month know that that happened. There's a Twitter account, mobileportland, and there's an IRC channel that is full of people. Two of them. But it has doubled in size. Growing like gangbusters. That's the sort of hockey puck growth that you expect in the mobile era. I'm a little chump, a little crazy this one. Okay, I wanted to thank our sponsors. Anyone from Urban Airship here?
No.
Okay, so I will talk about Urban Airship. So Urban Airship provides push notifications and in-app purchase, and also just recently bought a company that does Passbook, which is a really big deal. They have a bunch of job openings. They are the people who provide us this space, even when there was some confusion and had to like really make a lot of changes quickly to accommodate us this month. So it was great of them to do that. They also provide the beer. So if you didn't already like them, you should like them even more. And please go take a look at their job postings. Second sponsor's campaign monitor. So normally we send out the emails every month, and we use campaign monitor to send the emails. We've been using campaign monitor for years. This month though, they went above and beyond because they started helping us out by providing free credits for Mobile Portland, which is really awesome. And then on accident, we used them to send out a client campaign and like totally blew through all Mobile Portland's credits. And so I had to send this email to them and say, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. How do we fix this? And they're like, oh, mistakes happen. Here's 10,000 more credits. Just give us an extra special thank you this month. So this is the extra special thank you. They really rock. And they speak with Australian accents. It's really great. And then my company, before we started Mobile Portland, we helped organize. Your group could be up here next month, so see me if you're interested. Now I want to see if there are any job openings or, say, announcements, events coming up that people want to chat about. And I think Matt is going to run around with the microphone. So since he's running around with the microphone instead of me, if we could really alternate from this side of the room to the other side of the room so he has to exercise more, I would really appreciate it. Anyone?
Hi, Rich Clausen with the Portland Area .NET User Group. Next month, we are not really doing .NET so much as Frankie Andrews coming to present Scrum is Dumb, and I took some notes, How I Learned to Stop Burning Down and Love Agile, part three of the Agile Sucks series. That is February 5th. And on March 5th, we haven't picked the subject yet, but one Jason Grigsby will be joining us to present.
Yeah. Yeah, so you don't want to go.
No, definitely want to be there. Yes, it's way out in the boondocks of Hillsboro at Intel's Hawthorne Farms. We usually start at 6, first Tuesdays of the month.
He didn't tell me that when he asked me.
Hi, I'm Rachel with Tech Systems. I posted a job description to the website, but I'm currently working on 9 open iOS positions, or all contract to hire, for a large sportswear company we work in.
Never heard of them.
If you're interested in learning more, please feel free to come talk to me. I'm also LinkedIn, Rachel Hoppenberger. It's only one of me. So feel free to reach out. I can tell you more about that, as well as other iOS positions.
Hi, I'm Kevin Long from Carl Compass. We do mobile apps for events and conferences. We're hiring a server engineer, quality engineer, Android developer, front-end web developer, and a product consultant. So if you're looking for a mobile job, check out Carl Compass. Thanks.
Hi, Dave Howell at Avatron Software, home of air login, air sharing, whatever those other apps are, for this part. Obviously, we need a marketing person. So we do. And we also need iOS help and engineering, and also Windows.
One other announcement that I forgot about. Stephen Osborne, who's been one of the co-founders of Urban Airship and who's been helping out a lot with Mobile Portland, he is starting a new group called Thing Tuesdays, or Tuesday Things? Thing Tuesdays, which is all about Internet of Things, and so it's machine-to-machine related devices. It's not, you know, it may seem like it's not directly mobile related, but I actually think that the interaction between devices is probably the next big threshold, the next big thing that people are going to be working on. And it's great to see a bunch of people interested in that and starting to work on that here in Portland. So, you know, if you want to know where this group of people will be like 5 years from now or 2 years from now, that's probably where that'll be really interesting stuff. So I recommend doing it. And it's the, does anyone know?
Third Tuesday.
Third Tuesday. Thank you. All right, let's move on. Device lab. So one of the things that Mobile Portland does is we organize a device lab, a bunch of devices that people can test on. It's currently hosted at our office at Cloud 4, but you can go on the site, you can see, I think we've got about 40 different devices that people can test on. Fill out the form and let us know what device you want to test on, and you can come to the facility and test on that device. You do need to give us a heads up on when you're going to be there, because we're not always in the office, we sometimes take lunch breaks. And the other reason is that some of the devices are actually personal devices, like if you want to test on a Google TV, then I will have to go get the Google TV from my entertainment center and bring it to the office. But I would love it if somebody wanted to test an app on Google TV. It would make me really, really happy.
You keep it
there, so
you keep it.
Yeah, no, it's mine.
Oh.
Google gave it to me. What else can we say about this? There have been some new additions to the device lab. Intel donated a couple of Intel-based Android phones. Motorola, something I.
Razer.
Razer I. Hey, the gentleman who helped us do it. Awesome. So please, give Intel a round of applause, because that's awesome. Device, and if you have devices that you want to donate, that's awesome. Please talk to me or talk to Ilya. And then in addition, Brendan is somewhere there. Yes, so we've been looking at this really, really cool site that will allow you to register your phones that you have so that you can either loan them to other people if people want to borrow them, or meet them at a coffee shop so that they can test with you, or maybe they just send you an application or a website that they're hoping that you can go test on your device and then send them back, you know, screenshots or information. And so this website allows people to register those devices, and it's really, really close. The big holdup has been me, but I looked at it and things are looking good. And so The other thing we need is we need people to volunteer to help manage devices. Sort of like we're going to need to put a bunch of devices in and sort of moderate submissions and things of that nature. Sort of help the community get accustomed to the site. So if you're interested in that, I think we're going to point you to the render. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, excellent. Okay, so one last thing before we get Patrick on here, and I'm looking at this next slide and realizing that I have a huge typo on it, but still, regardless, I just want to say congratulations to Matt, because his baby arrived this month. So for those who have not been around the past, Matt has been organizing the meetings for most of 2012, and we'll be taking them back over next month, whether he knows it or not. But this month we had a baby. We didn't think we were going to have him here this month, but the Hazel came early. And so congratulations on that. And with that, I want to introduce Patrick Thompson. Patrick is the founder and CEO of Inkstone Mobile. After having been involved in many, many startups and sort of advising people both in Portland and I think also the Bay Area, sort of helping other companies. Inkstone Mobile, I don't know if you guys remember this, he probably will be showing this video, so maybe I won't, but there's a really, really funny video. Is that, Patrick, the video that you were going to show? Yes, okay. So I will not spoil the video. It was the first time I heard of Inkstone Mobile, and so I will show that. And it's going to talk about all the different ways that they've marketed their apps and the ways that they've been very successful. 4 million downloads and featured in the App Store and a bunch of different, I think, different code bases, different apps from the same code base. So please help me welcome Patrick Thompson.
So I decided, okay, I'll bootstrap this, but I've got to scale back and do something something small. And I looked at the iPhone App Store, and you know, there were like 50,000 apps on the store at the time. I thought, boy, that's a lot. I don't know if but you know, it looked like there's some holes and some things I could build. So just a few thoughts about bootstrapping. You know, I think that a lot of people, for anything, for either a bootstrap company or a regular company, they want the perfect idea, and they wait for the perfect idea, and of course the perfect idea never comes. You know, I'd say just start. And once you start, things happen. Even if your idea isn't perfect in the beginning, mine wasn't, things will happen, and you will follow a course that may take you to success. I like what Ewan Fagan says, is know when you are getting lucky in business and follow that. It's true, you'll get lucky, but you need to recognize it. And the way I think about it is, the way my business has progressed is I climbed the first hill, and so it was my first app. I didn't know what I was going to do beyond that, but I'm going to do this app. And I got to the top of that hill, and other things opened up. Oh, this is what I'll do next. I didn't know what I'd do beyond that, but I climbed that next hill. And the next thing opened up, and it just keeps going and going like that. So I'd say just climb the first hill and see where it takes you. I'm a developer. I've been a developer, you know, all my career. How many people here are developers? Okay, about half. Marketers? Business people? Other? Okay, great. I covers everyone. So I'm a developer, and so I think about things like a developer. So I think about my business like a developer. I think about my marketing like a developer. And you can turn that mentality to your advantage. As developers, we're used to solving hard problems. That's what we do every day. We're put on a new project, we start something new, we don't know anything about it, we figure it out, and we come up with a solution. And I apply this to my business, and I call it an incremental business development. So the way I develop software is I start with the smallest thing possible, right? You know, hello world. Just get something working. You know, make sure it's solid, and then you build on top of that. So you're always building on something that's working, and you incrementally build that out. And that's how I've built my business, as you see. Another way to think about it is baseball. So if you've got venture funding, you can go for the home runs. If you don't have venture funding, if you're funding yourself, think singles and doubles. You can still play a good baseball game with singles and doubles and getting the occasional triple, and you can still win the game. And the last thing I'd say is go all in. The way I did is I had some money, and I decided, okay, I'll take this much money, put it in the bank. If I run out of this money, I'm done. Okay, I have to go get a job. And that's the last thing I did. So I started in, and I didn't do any consulting except for one job, which was in early 2010. I did one consulting job, and it was a really interesting project. It was a lot of fun, but I was miserable. Every time I worked on the project, I was thinking about, oh, I wish I was working on my own project. I'd like to get back to my own project. And I decided after that, you know, no more. I just have to go all in, you know, burn the boats. You know, the story of Cortez, who, you know, they say he burned the boats so, you know, his people, his men couldn't retreat. You know, if you can't leave, you've got to just go forward. And I'd say that's the right attitude for bootstrapping or any startup. The other thing is, don't try and do freelancing and product at the same time. If you don't have enough money, go do freelancing for a while, save up money, be frugal, and then go all in. I love this quote from Seth Godin. I think that when people are dancing on the edge of failure, and they are growing, and there's a void over there, but they keep moving forward, that's when we feel alive as people. And that's so true about doing a startup and putting yourself out there, and you're on the edge, and you don't know if it's going to work. You feel like you're in a movie where, you know, you've got these highs and lows, and you don't know how it's going to end. You're the main character, and you don't know how the movie's going to end. So let's get to the app. So I when I was thinking of ideas, I had used a speed reading app like 10 or 15 years ago, and it was terrible, and I thought, I could do this better. And when I was looking for ideas, I looked at the App Store. There weren't any good speed reading apps. I thought, well, that's a good idea. I can fill an inch there, and this will be this is a good opportunity for me. So my first app was Quick Reader. And I call it the speed reading ebook reader. It's an ebook reader that has a guide that moves through the text. Like, have you ever seen people at the airport or on a plane, using their finger as a guide or a pen? It's the same idea, but a computer version of that.
So it works like this. So you select a book, then a chapter. I don't know if you can see this. And there's a guide that moves through the text.
And you can change the speed from 10 to 4,000 words per minute. You can change the number of stops per line of college. Set the speed, the guide stops, so how many times it stops per line, we can do multiple lines at a time so it'll move down. Let's do two stops per line, 670 words per minute. You can set, you can have different guide styles. We'll just stick with the highlight. You can customize text color, page color, font size, and this is two stops per line at 670 words per minute. Okay, so this is what the app was. Then I created a free version of the app. The initial app had like 10 textbooks in it, just my own custom format. The light version had just one book. But the whole idea around the app was I wanted this computer-based guide, but I also wanted you to be able to pull in your own books, interesting material. Most of these speed reading apps have really boring sections that you read, and it's not very much fun. So I want you to be able to pull in your own text. I integrated with Instapaper, so you can import your Instapaper documents. But I wanted a lot more books. So I added support for EPUB, which is an ebook standard. And I talked to the guys at FeedBooks, Adrian Gardur, who they had some really nicely formatted EPUB books, nice chapters. And I asked them, can I use your books? Can I take your books from your site, these free public domain books, and can I incorporate them into my app? He said, sure, yeah, that's fine. Just keep the attribution in there, and you can take as many as you want. So I took that as a license. So I added 50 books to Quick Reader, and then I created French, German, and Spanish editions, and I localized the app along the way. And then I created the Young Reader Edition with age-appropriate books, 130 age-appropriate books for kids. But at the same time I was talking to Adrian, he said, I'm involved in this standard called OPDS, myself and Internet Archive and Free Press Consulting. And if you added support for OPDS, which is this open book catalog standard, you'll get access to not only all of the FeedBooks books, but all of Internet Archive's books and Gutenberg.org's books and any other archive or catalog out there that supports OPDS. But that's good. You see what's happening here? Opportunity. So I added OPDS support, which is a hierarchical catalog standard. So there's a number of different catalogs. You choose a catalog. And then they're hierarchical, so you go through a number of different navigation pages. And then you get to a list of books. And then you can navigate through the books, and then you can select a book, and then you can download the book, read the book. So this was nice. So by this time, my apps had grown into a general ebook reader, right? It was a speed reading app, but it was really an ebook reader, and it cost $5, and nobody bought it as an ebook reader because it cost $5. So I thought, well, why don't I just strip out the speed reading functionality and create a new app at $2, just a straight ebook reader, and that was a mega reader. And I created a light version of that with a set number of books. You could navigate the catalogs, but you couldn't download the books, which didn't really work too well. That app was they didn't appreciate that when they went to download a book, they didn't want nothing. So I thought, okay, I have these, eight apps now. What else can I do? What else can I strip out? It's kind of interesting. I started with Quick Reader and I added all this functionality, and now I'm stripping it out. And finally, I thought, well, what if I just take out the ebook reader? and I'll just allow you to get the books and then open them in iBooks or the Kindle app or whatever ebook reader you want, because, you know, people have their ebook readers of choice. I'm missing a whole market there. You know, all the people who love iBooks, they're not going to use Mega Reader. So why don't I serve them somehow? So I created eBook Search, which is a free app that allows you to find those books.
Same way, you just open up the catalogs, go on that screen there, and then you can go and find a book. And now when you download it, it asks you what format you want. It presents all the formats that are available. It downloads it, and then it allows you to open it in the ebook reader of your choice. And that app did really well. Much better than my paid apps. So these are the kind of historical downloads of that free app. And it, you know, it's had a great spike. And then, you know, for the longest time, it's around, averaging around 5,000 downloads until recently. This was a Christmas spike. And we're in a Christmas spike here, but it seems to be more than that one. I also added in-app purchases for 99 cents. And you could add, two in-app purchases, one to remove the advertising and the other to add two more extra catalogs. Those didn't work too well either. I get some sales of those, but not so much. But then I decided, well, why don't I create a paid version of my free app? And I created eBook Search Pro, which has two extra catalogs and no advertising. And it's another SKU, it's another product on the paid books category, and that's done pretty well. So I got involved in this OPDS standards committee, and you know, we have these regular calls. And one day we were talking about how can we support other media types in OPDS, like audiobooks. And one of the guys said, well, we know Hugh McGuire, who's the founder of LibriVox. If we could get him to create an OPDS catalog, would you create an audiobook app? I said, sure, yeah, I've been thinking about doing that. I've been thinking about doing that anyway. So Hadrian and I worked with the guys at LibriVox. Their developer created a prototype really quickly, everything looked great, and then he left. And then they ran into server issues, and then they ran into funding issues, and this went on for quite a while. Finally, I decided, okay, I just need to do this myself. I need to create my own server to create these audiobook catalogs. And it turned out to be a blessing in disguise, because when I started creating this, I created the infrastructure to import catalogs, not just LibriVox, but any catalog, and to be able to create different catalogs out of that content, and to be able to import other catalogs. So I imported other audiobook catalogs, and I imported ebook catalogs. So it's really opened up a whole number of possibilities that I'm just starting to explore with my apps. And the first manifestation of that is the my audiobooks HQ app, which I just released in early December. And as you'll see, it's very similar to my other apps. It has a book library. These are some things I'll talk about later. So you can you know, choose a book from the library.
In the last chapter of our history, Don Quixote and his faithful squire Sancho Panza were preparing to leave Orizaya, set in the midst of the desolate plains of Elantra. Don Quixote, concerned lest he infringe upon the laws of knight errantry, refused to pay thee.
So I'm a runner, and I like to speed up and slow down the playback. Usually speed it up. And that was one of the things I wanted to do with that app, which I was showing you. This is the OPDS catalogs again, exactly the same code, really, the slight tweak. And now when you go to download a book, you can listen to the audio. So you can see what I'm doing here. These apps are all out of the same code base. I looked for different ways that I can create new apps, new apps with value. Usually I have to add something, some incremental functionality, but then that's something that I can roll into the other apps, so it brings, you know, the functionality of those apps up. as well. My most recent app was an audio Bible app with 10 audio Bibles. And I have 4 more audiobook apps planned. A free one, a French audiobook app, a poetry app, and a kids audiobook app. And I have 2 more apps that I don't want to talk about yet, also out of the same code base, but in a whole new category for me. To date, all of these have been in the books category. So looking at the, just a quick look at the numbers before, we'll come back to this later. This is, each color is a different app. So this is Quick Reader back in 2009. You can see a couple spikes, which I'll talk about in a minute. And then this is Meta Reader. Oh, these small colored ones here, those are the French, German, and Spanish editions and the younger edition. Not much, but we'll look at the middle revenue. This is Meta Reader, providing the bulk of the revenue. This is eBook Search Pro. I released eBook Search way back here. I should have released this earlier, I mean, but oh well. And then this red here is the audiobook apps. So that's the story of the apps. A few things about product management or how you choose what you're going to build and what's important. I think the main thing is you know, the app has to work well. It has to satisfy a need. It has to look nice. And developers, don't do your own apps, please. Don't even think about it. Really, if you yeah, you're just wasting your time. You might as well sit on the couch and watch TV. I mean, it's, go get a good designer. The other thing is aim for the masses. I believe on the App Store, with the price points being so low, you really need to shoot for apps that have mass appeal, that potentially have millions of users. I think niche apps can work if they have a large enough population or a large enough audience, and you can command a higher price, but those are pretty rare. It's better to play it safe and go for the masses. International appeal. 65% of, I don't know if you can read that, but 65% of my revenue is non-US. This is the US, this is non-US. If I wasn't going after the international market, my overall revenue would be much less, obviously. I think people game foreign app stores less. I think there's more gaming of the US app store. And you have an opportunity to stand out, especially if you do a good job of localizing your app and you localize your screenshots and your name and your keywords. You have a good opportunity to stand out. I think people focus more on the US app store. And this is just to show international free sale. So this is an ebook search. This is US, which is only 20% of my total downloads. And interestingly, I find it interesting, in the paid downloads, Russia is my number 2 market. I think that they're readers. I think Russians are readers. That's why. You know, it depends on your product and, you know, what and the country. But I think every app is going to be different. And for my free app, China is my number 2. Notice they're not even on the pay chart. they download a lot, and I have advertising, so you know I do get revenue from that. But they sure don't buy much. And create a portfolio, like I was just showing you. I did. You know, don't just rush out and create a whole new code base. Look for, you know, ways you can reuse or repurpose your existing code base. Look for adjacent opportunities. You diversify your app portfolio. Make free apps, paid apps, iPhone, iPad, localized, mass market, niche. So, for example, my Quick Reader app, I created the main Quick Reader app, and then I created those niche, you know, language-specific ones and the Young Reader ones. You know, but they don't do as well, but they add to the mix. And diversifying your revenue sources, so app sales, advertising, affiliate income, in-app purchases, subscriptions, I'll add to the mix. And when you're bootstrapping, I mean, the dream of it, every independent app developer is to become a sustainable business, right? So you scratch and fight for every dollar to make it to the next day, the next quarter, the next year. The other thing is user engagement. You want to, especially with free apps where people can just download them at whim, you want them to be able to be successful with the app very quickly so that they spend time in the app and see banner ads and other advertising, but also so they keep coming back and they enjoy the app and they tell their friends and then you get that organic growth. So a few thoughts about marketing before I get into the specific tactics that I use. So this is targeted towards developers. Marketing to a developer can be really counterintuitive because people are not rational. But the good news is they're usually irrational in the same way. So you can target for that. People tend to act in their own self-interest, which is important to know. And it's not about you. They don't care about how cool your thing is. They care about what it's going to do for them. On the App Store, visibility is everything, right? There's 780,000 apps on the iOS App Store. I don't know how many on Android. If somebody can't see your app, that they're not going to buy it. It's just that simple. There's hundreds of millions of device owners, and you say, well, if I just had 0.01% of those users, if they just bought my app, how much is that? But if they don't see you, they can't buy your app. The traditional methods of getting downloads, and the first one is both a means and an end, right? You want to be in the top 100 of a category, certainly the top 200. On iTunes, people see the top 200. On the iPhone, they see the top 100 if their finger doesn't get tired, because you have to scroll over. It's a lot harder than before to see those top 100 on the App Store. But you want to be in the top 100, otherwise you're virtually invisible. Of course, people can find you with search if you have good keywords. So of course, do good keyword research. Advertising, it's never worked for me, but I know people who say it works for them, so it's certainly something to try. Whenever I do advertising, I use a Dave Howell's method of always having the price prominently displayed there, so they know that it's a paid app. Get featured by Apple on the App Store, which is super hard. It's kind of like winning the lottery. Press and blog features, social media, and unfortunately, cheat. Some people cheat. Apparently, you can pay somebody to have people in China download your apps, because the way the rankings work on the App Store is by number of downloads. So the more people that download your app, the higher you are in the rankings. The higher you are in the rankings, the more people see you. So people will pay to drive their app up into the rankings. Please don't do that. So I think of creating levers within my app. So part of the development I do, not all the development I do is feature development. A lot of it, not a lot of it, but a certain percentage is developing for marketing, creating these levers. So in-app ads typically come from the framework you're using for advertising. But nag messages, messages that come up when somebody opens the app, more screens or recommendation screens, push notifications. A push notification, typically, when you click on one, it just takes you to the app, which isn't very useful. But what you can do is you can actually add your own data to that push notification. You can do some interesting things in the app with that. So I built out that kind of infrastructure. Paid versus free. So you have to think of paid and free as two different markets. you can't get caught up on, oh, I'm going to cannibalize my paid sales because I'm creating a free app with all of this content. Because I believe that in general you have people who typically only download paid apps. You know, they don't typically look for, is there a free version of this? And you have people who only download free apps. And they don't look for a paid version. So, you know, target both categories. Free apps, of course, get a lot more downloads. You can use free apps to build your audience and visibility. Think of it as a feeder channel for your paid apps, as well as, you know, some incremental revenue from advertising and in-app purchases and maybe affiliate income. But the thing is, and the thing that I found is, you really need to add significant value in your free apps. There's a guy named Ibn Pagan who says you need to move the free line, and I found it's true. In my early light apps, they were disabled, and you know, I got these terrible reviews. And for MegaReader Lite, I finally just took it off the market because it wasn't doing anything for me. And then I came out with eBook Search, and that just went crazy because I was providing a lot of value, and it didn't cannibalize my paid app sales. In fact, it enhanced them because I was able to cross-promote from my free apps to my paid apps. Okay, so let's get into some stories. So it was 2009. I had just released Quick Reader, and there happened to be one of these Apple iPhone Tech Talk World Tours up in Seattle. So I thought that's great. I went up there, and in the opening keynote, they said we're going to have a UI evangelist reviewing apps. So after the keynote, I ran up there and got myself on the list, and I showed one of these UI evangelists my app, and he said, this is really nice. I mean, in the day, I mean, my old UI, I mean, it still looks nice, but it looks a bit dated. At the time, most of the apps were plain vanilla. You know, not very many people use designers and had customized UI. So he said, this is really nice. You have to take this and show this to one of our marketing people downstairs. So he directed me, you know, where to go and who to talk to. And she liked the app too. And a week later, I was on the What's Hot list. And I think I'll show you what happened, but I think the lesson there is you can't, there's really no way to get an Apple feature, but if you can get it in front of Apple employees, it helps your case. So here are the results. And actually, I'm showing, I got featured a second time too when I released my iPad version of Quick Reader. So here's that first feature, you know, great spike. I was at a conference last year, I was at Singleton. One of the speakers was saying, if you get featured by Apple, it'll change your life. And I'm there thinking, yeah, for 2 weeks. what I found is sales kind of settled out at a higher level than they were before. But you know, when you first get featured, you're like, oh yeah, I've got a paid. But it doesn't work out that way. But you know, the sales settled out higher. The same thing happened here. There's a bigger spike. And you can see that, you know, the general line here, it did settle out at a higher level. So I would recommend getting featured by Apple. So the next thing I'm going to talk about is a campaign idea. And I had been reading some of these articles about, you know, this girl who fell into a manhole while texting in her parents' suit. And these paddings that they were putting on lampposts in the UK, in London. It cracked me up. And I had this idea, and I sat down the day I did some, I prototyped this heads-up feature, so you can see the camera view behind the text. And I showed it to a friend of mine who has a tech blog in the UK, at the Red Ferret Journal. We were just cracking up, and so he wrote a press release for me, tongue-in-cheek, talking about the dangers of you know, texting and walking, and how, you know, Inkstone, you know, really cares about our users. So, So we've added this feature, and we even have a guide for recommendations for how to practice reading while walking. And I did a video which I'll show you in just a second. It did really well. It got picked up by Engadget, Gizmodo, Huffington Post, Silicon Floors. I don't know Rick, but he's been really supportive, and he doesn't know me, but he's been really supportive of me over these years. He's featured my apps several times in Silicon Floors, and I really appreciate that. Here's a video. Links a day, and even to this day, I still get quite a few from that. Next is NAG messages, which this is, you do this in free apps. So when somebody opens your app, you show them a message. And this is just a custom modal dialogue. You can also show, you know, a regular screen, you know, an image. But mine are pretty simple. So this is in the free version of ebook search, obviously promoting the pro version of ebook search. And when I first did this, I was pretty amazed at the results. This here is a funnel graph from Appsalar. Appsalar is an analytics company, so it allows you to track your downloads and stuff. But they have this really interesting feature called funnels. So you can basically say, okay, if this event happens, and then this event happens, and then this event happens, that's my funnel. So my events are, I show this dialogue. The second event is somebody clicked on the Learn More button, which takes them to the App Store. And then the third event is somebody opened eBook Search Pro. So in this way, I can track, you know, does this really work? Which early on, this was before I used AppSolar, I was looking for something like that because I couldn't tell, do people that use my Lite app actually use, do they actually buy my paid app? There's no way to tell because the apps are so opaque. So this was a way that I could do it. And so if you look at this, this is the number of people who saw the that dialogue. So it's like 45,000 and some odd users. 23% of those clicked on the Learn More button. And of those, 7% actually bought the app for an end-to-end conversion rate of like 1.5%. And if you know about conversion rates, at least in the advertising, the banner advertising I do in ebook search, I typically get about a 1.5% click-through rate. So this is pretty pretty incredible, and the impact was pretty incredible. So this is, we're looking at eBook Search Pro here. So this is the launch. I had a good launch, and then it kind of settled out here. I thought, okay, you know, that's about meeting my expectations. Okay, we're good. And then it did this, then it did this. And then, you know, this is your typical launch, right?
Yeah.
This is what you see, right? You have a big spike, and then this, and then it keeps going like this, you know, and asymptotically approaches infinity as you go out of time. But this is where I introduce that NAG message. And this message, I can control whether I show it repeatedly or whether I show it just once. So this time I just showed it once to a given user. And then I let it go. So I got up in the rankings and I got that natural conversion because I was up in the apps, the books category rankings, so people could see it, so people were buying it. So I was able to maintain that. And then also new people who were downloading ebook search as well, they were seeing the NAG message for the first time as well. So that was also sustaining them. And then this was a weekend I did it again. I refreshed that so repeat users would see it again. And I got another spike and I did it on the following weekend. And then again, this is a very powerful mechanism. And it's a very good reason in itself to have a free app, to have this feeder to your paid apps. So the next thing I'd like to talk about is push notifications. So I was having coffee with my friend Rob Manigali, and this was 2.5 years ago. And he opens up his laptop and says, look at this. I added push notifications to my app. He opens up his Urban Airship console. People actually agree to it. People actually put them in. So a push notification is, it allows you to send a message to an app user even when they don't have the app open. But the thing is, when they first download the app and open the app, they have to agree to get those messages. And we were both really surprised how many people actually said yes. So I didn't really know what I would do with it, but I thought, what the heck, you know, this is really interesting. I'll just add it to my app. And 2.5 years later, I have 980,000 active push users, and it'll be over a million in a few So I can open up a browser right now, go to my Urban Airship console, and I can send a message to nearly a million people. It blows my mind. But don't get carried away. I think the danger of push notifications is people are starting to abuse it. So that they'll use it for everything, repeatedly. Now, I think it's affecting how many people agree to get push notifications. I actually, with my audio, with a campaign I did with my audiobook app, a free for a day campaign, I only saw about a 20% agreement to get push notifications. So use them very sparingly. I typically use them for like if I have an announcement or new content available. But I'd recommend that you start collecting active devices right away. Add push notifications to your apps. Even if you don't know what you're going to do with it, just do it. And it's really good for user engagement. Again, bringing people back to the app. Oh, I have 1,000 more books. I added a new catalog. You know, something that will entice them to come back to the app and re-engage with it. Next is I did a free for a day campaign. This is actually the second one I did. This one I did with the audiobook app. And so the way this works, I did this with AppsFire, which is a service where they have an app, and they have a lot of users, and if you do a free campaign with them, they'll do a push notification to all of their users and tell them this, it's some kind of promotion. So the best kind of promotion is a free promotion. You can do a price drop, or it can just be, you know, see my app. But the most effective one is to do a free promotion. So I did that, and that's what this is here. So this was the launch of my app. You know, it had a good launch, but then it kind of settled out. And also, this was Christmas here, too, which, at least in the books category, there are lots of kids apps, and we just get pummeled with people promoting, Disney and all these brands, Dora promoting their app and trying to drive up their ranking for Christmas, and it's really hard to compete. I just got pummeled there. This is Christmas. I didn't see any spike at all. So I waited till after Christmas, after the New Year, and I did this free campaign. And I was a bit concerned about the transition from paid back to free, because the downloads you get while you're free don't count towards paid downloads. So they don't impact your paid category ranking. So I was a bit concerned about that transition, but it actually worked out really well. In these free campaigns, it's a worldwide campaign. So you start in Australia and then it goes all around the world. So you basically have to keep your app free for 2.5 days. So on the third day, 8:30 in the morning, I pressed the button to make it paid again. And I went and looked at the App Store, and I was still in paid. Though now it said $1.99 instead of free. But I was still, I had gotten up to, I think, 47 in the free iPhone, overall free iPhone category. And I was, like 50, 60 in the free category. That was $1.99. And I was number two in the books category. And it stayed that way for 8 hours. So there was 8 hours where I was highly ranked in the free category. And during that time, I had lots of visibility, and people were, even though it was in the free category, they were buying it. And which is what happened here. So I got this great spike. It drove me up into the high end of the books category. And I've pretty much been able to maintain that till now. So that was my recovery from the Christmas hangover. The next thing I want to talk about is your icon. So how you present your app on the App Store. So your icon, your name, your screenshots, your app description. These are all super important, because these are what people see of your app on the App Store. They don't know anything about you. The first thing they see is your icon. So it better be pretty good. It needs to really pop.
if you will. I don't know if it's a coincidence, but my two highest ranked apps, Free and Paid, are both red. So your icon has to be really good. It has to really stand out against the other icons. The second thing they look at is your name. Okay, so your name needs to mean something to them. If you are a, you know, one developer shop, and you know you've got some brand, nobody knows your brand. You know, nobody. It'll just confuse them. You really want something meaningful here. Now, on the iPhone App Store, you really only see very little now. It used to be more, but on the iTunes App Store, you do see more. But still, you should have a very meaningful. So they like your icon, they click on it, and this is what they see. They see your icon again, okay, they already saw that. They see, you know, your whole name and your tagline if you have one. It's probably a good idea to have a tagline because they're going to read this first. So to give them some idea of what your app's about, you know, every moment that goes on, you're going to lose people. You want to keep people going through this, you know, funnel, if you will, as long as possible. The longer they stick with you, the more likely they are to buy or download your app. The next thing they'll probably look at is your screenshot of your ranking, or your rating. So, you know, you should do whatever you can to make that look good. And they'll look at your screenshot. So your screenshot needs to be meaningful. I'll talk more about that in a sec, but the last thing they look at is your description. So your description is way down the line, but still, the description, they see that first paragraph. So really, on your description, really focus on that first paragraph. It needs to really be compelling. And then they might click through. Okay, but what I want to talk a little bit more about is this screenshot. So you can just have plain screenshots of your app, and that's what I would say the majority of the people do. But the flaw with that is you're expecting people to see what you want them to see. You look at that screenshot and you say, oh, look, so many books. Oh, look at my fancy slider to change the playback speed. They'll, of course, notice that. They're not going to notice that. You need to tell them what they need to see, what they need to look at. And the first screenshot, as we saw earlier, it's really prominent. I mean, it's right here. So this is a great opportunity to have some sales copy. You know, turn your first screenshot at least into an advertisement. And you know, call out the really important features of your app, why they would want to download it, why this app would be important to them. And this is what I've done this with all my apps. And I've known this for a long time, I've only done it recently. I know the CTO, or the former CTO of Me Genius, another book category guy, and they've done this, and they've measured it. And you know, they told me that this works, and I don't know why I didn't do it earlier, because it really does have an impact. This is an ebook search. Again, this is an App Annie graph of my ranking. And for the longest time, you know, I've kind of been averaging around 30. Sometimes it goes into the high 20s, you know, sometimes it goes into, you know, mid-30s. But kind of 30 was average. This is where I introduced my advertisement screenshot for ebook search. And that took me up into the 20s. Like 16, you know, I got up to like 13 at one point. And it's stayed there. So there's a clear impact. I recommend that you do that. Next is a name. So names are important. This is a competitor of mine. He's a formidable competitor. He writes great sales copy. He's got good graphics, a nice icon, and he's got a great name. Free books, free audiobooks. Does anybody not know what these apps are? It's great ebook search. That's a really good name. That's better than Mega Reader. It's better than Quick Reader. It tells people, it gives people, people can imagine what this app is. I'm going to go quickly now because I'm running out of time. Support, so we saw our rating earlier in the App Store. One way that you can help support
that you can help get a higher rating is to make it as easy as possible for people to contact you, to talk to you, to you know, to either praise you or to vent. And if they're able to vent, they're less likely to, you know, go to the trouble, to go to the app store, to find your app, and to enter a negative review. This is a tool I'm using from AppSpire called App Booster that allows people to, it allows me to send messages, in-app messages to the users, but it also allows them to give feedback and to rate the app, and also App Booster will go back to them if they rate it highly and suggest that they review it in the App Store. App Portfolio Mix, so as I was referring to earlier, you know, these are my quick reader apps, and you can see this is the main quick reader app on the bottom. Each of the individual apps above don't really give a lot of revenue, but in aggregate, you know, they're maybe 20-25% of total revenue, so it helps. And then it's also important to have a mix of apps, different apps, because you know, it's hard to survive on those low price points with just one app. So create different apps. Create new apps. This is just an idea, but there's no way to, like on the web, if you have a sales page, you can tell how many people visit, how many people click through, how many people actually buy. You know your end-to-end conversion rate. We don't know that on the App Store. But you can, there are different ways you can create proxies to test that. So you can create an advertisement. So I advertise in my own free app, right, to cross-promote my other apps. You can put a tagline there. If you want to say test a tagline for your app name, you can put that in an advertisement and see what the click-through rate is. You can use an interstitial ads, which are like full screen ads, to test your screenshot copy. But this is how you deal when something doesn't go quite right. I'll just go through these quickly. So I, as I mentioned earlier, I haven't had any luck paying for advertising. I've gone through a couple periods where I paid a lot of money for advertising and I didn't get a result, though I know people who it does work for. I hired some high-end copywriters, which were really expensive, and the thing is that they don't really understand your user audience as well as you do. So even if they're a high-end copywriter, I think you're better off learning to write copy yourself, and you'll get much better results and it'll be cheaper. The other thing is, I'll just skip to the web. That wasn't a misadventure for me, but I think it can be. I'd say don't focus much attention on the web. I think people go to the web only to validate that this looks like a real company. You know, they don't have some cheesy website or some, they use it for validation. I don't think very many people actually discover your apps through the web. So looking back at the kind of the sales over time, these are my my Apple feature spikes. You can see, you know, around Christmas we usually get spikes. The head promo was here, the video was here. You know, you can see as new products came online, how it's adding to the revenue. Resources, so I like to run and listen to podcasts and audiobooks while I run. And these are some of my favorite. I like Mixergy with Andrew Warner. He interviews successful entrepreneurs and talks about their journey and how they got there and what they did. It's really interesting. I Love Marketing is obviously a podcast about marketing with Joe Polish and Dean Jackson. Seth Godin's Startup School. If you're not familiar with Seth Godin's, I'm thinking this is kind of like an overview. It's a series of podcasts from a course he did last year. Developing Perspective with David Smith. He's actually a competitor of mine, but I met him last year. He's a real nice guy. And he's got a nice app called Check the Weather. I'd recommend you buy that, but don't buy his audiobook. mine's better. Just kidding. He's a great guy. He's got this podcast where he talks about development and kind of the experience of being a developer and indie app developer. And finally, Startups for the Rest of Us is a podcast about bootstrapping from my friends Rob Walling and Mike Tabor. And they also do the MicroConf conference in Las Vegas every year. It's it was just announced and sold out in like 2 days, but if you get a chance to go next year, it's a great conference. Books. There's this one book. So most of the app marketing books, I mean, they'll tell you pretty much what you can read on the web. The only one that I've really found that talks about kind of this idea of an app portfolio is this one called App Empire. And be warned, it's kind of one of these hyped, become an app billionaire kind of books. But what he talks about with respect to research, app store research, and also marketing, using this kind of portfolio strategy that I use is any Seth Godin book is great. I like all marketers are alive. Hackers and Painters, Paul Graham, any of his essays. He has an essay in that book where he talks about creating wealth. It's amazing how, just having your brain out of nothing, you can create a product and make money. It's pretty incredible. And also, I'd recommend that you learn direct response to marketing and copywriting. Direct response just means marketing where you're trying to get an immediate response from something, like to buy it now, as opposed to like brand marketing where you want to promote your brand so people know your brand. This is, you want somebody to buy your app, how can you compel them to do that? Tools, App Booster, which I talked about, that in-app feedback tool. Firstly, I use for advertising. I've also heard good things about MoPub. It wasn't around in the time that I was implementing it, but I've heard good things about MoPub. AppSolar is the analytics tool I use that has the funnel analysis. AppViz is a Mac-based tool. A lot of the graphs I was showing you were from AppViz. AppFigures is a web-based tool. I usually use it for tracking my rankings. AppNanny is great for tracking ranking, especially competitor rankings over time. And then ErrorStack is it's a tool I use to find out when exceptions and problems happen in the app. It's a free open source tool. I think there are some paid tools now that are probably better than this, but this works well for me. And I have some code that integrates with it. If anyone's interested, I can send you some code. Local groups, Mobile Portland, of course. I'm a member of Thai. There's a bunch of groups here. I'd say find one entrepreneurship group that you resonate with. OEN is, they run Angel Portland. They have a lot of stuff about pitching and how to get funding. OTBC is in Beaverton. And SCORE is kind of a small business kind of organization, but they have these workshops and they have mentors. And I went to one of these workshops, all day workshops, when I was first getting started about how to start a business. And it was useful. So just on parting thoughts, just to recap, just start, burn the boats, roll in. Freelance or product, just choose one at a time. Aim for the masses. International appeal, add international support. I've localized my apps in 16 different languages besides English. I didn't show on the previous slide, but there's a service called ICANN Localize. It's 9 cents a word. You can manage your streams within their server. It's a great service for localizing. Look for derivative app opportunities. Diversify your app portfolio and revenue. On the marketing side, be exceptional, create a great app. Don't do your own graphics if you're a developer. Can I say that? Create members, marketing members, create visibility for your apps and cross-promote. But just a one word of caution, your mileage may vary. These are things that have worked for me. You need to get in there and experiment and try things for yourself. I hope this was useful for everyone, and if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
All right, here we go.
At what point were you profitable, and how many people did you have? When did you know you did have to work for the man?
So when I started generating revenue, like when you're in this situation, you're in a, it's like you're in a plane in a nosedive, and your job is to pull it out before you hit the ground. So, you know, I had this money in the bank, and I didn't run out of that money. So I was able to pull it out. At what point? Probably around the time I introduced Mega Reader. So, you know, Quick Reader wouldn't have sustained me. I was still bleeding at that point. But when I introduced Mega Reader, that's when things turned around. It was, maybe eight months. You know, it just depends on the product, how well it does. You know, there's no fixed time. But I'd say, you know, try and get products into the store and get them as successful as soon as possible.
Did you track the content your users gained access to, like which books they read the most, and did that give you valuable information about product placement and offerings within the app, and how you marketed them on in the iTunes store?
No, I haven't done that.
Can you track which books that you did download?
I can, but I haven't done that today. I could track it, but at least until now, I've chosen not to.
Why?
It's a matter of bandwidth. So, you know, there's lots of data you can track. You know, I've got tons of data in AppSolar, and I know I could do a lot more to analyze that data and to use that data to improve user engagement in my apps, but it just hasn't risen above the cut line.
Yes. Are your slides available somewhere?
I'd rather not make them available, but...
I wanted to get the names of the books and stuff.
You know, this is my contact info. If you have any questions or you want some clarification, then just, you know, send me an email and I'll... Thanks.
What does your support look like? I noticed you got very aggressive. I took a really hilarious approach to my less successful app adventures, which has users jumping through a lot of hoops to get support. I'm finding about 1,000 per download. What in 1,000 support requests per downloads, basically? I'm curious if you have any numbers based on permissive strategy like that.
I don't per download, but my support load is surprisingly light. Okay. I do get a lot of those feedback forms, but most of them are just, you know, thumbs up or, you know, optimal, you know, whatever language it is. And I use Google Translate, by the way, for support. And, you know, really it's good enough. And what I do is if I have a recurrent support issue in a specific language, I will have one of my translators translate so I can give a proper response. But I'll get quite a few of those every day, but only two or three of those I really need to respond to or some kind of problem or issue. So it's a lot of traffic, but it's not very much work to plow through it.
Yeah, you seem to have a lot of expertise in terms of what gets you a high ranking. And particularly I was interested in similar question this gentleman is asking. When people give you rankings, so 4 stars, 5 stars, I've been in a lot of apps and it seems like they're paying people to actually give them rankings. How does that affect where your app is ranked? So if you pay someone to go in there, because they're writing in broken English, and so it's clear that they're not English speakers, it's not their first language,
right.
And they're writing in broken English, something like, this app does me amazing things, right? or whatever it is.
Right.
Does that boost your ranking significantly? Like if you get a lot of people to rank your rep?
I don't know how the Apple's algorithm works and how or if rankings affect it. I've heard from other people who said that when they introduce a new app, their ranking goes down and they feel that that is because their old rankings get cleared out and they go to zero. I don't know if that's true or not. I've never really noticed that myself. So I don't know how that impacts your actual app store ranking. I haven't really noticed any correlation, not that there isn't one.
In your presentation here, I noticed you didn't mention anything about actually naming your app. One of the things in reading the guidelines of the App Store is sort of making a name for your app. In looking at one of your slides, a lot of the names actually got cut off or dot, dot, dots.
Right.
Did you take any consideration into the name of Mega Reader versus free audiobooks, which would be cut off after just six characters?
Well, I didn't. I would say the latest version of the App Store on the phone, it's made the amount of name you can see super short, you know, just like five or six characters. So it's especially bad now. It didn't used to be that bad. So when I was naming my apps, I didn't take that into consideration, but I have found that, as I mentioned in the presentation, that descriptive names work better than cute names.
Sort of following up on that, do you have a service that you use to check copyright for your app names?
I don't use a lawyer or a law firm to do that. I'll do web searches, and I'll check in the trademark. There's a USPTO website that has a trademark search that anyone can use. And they'll usually come after you if you'll know pretty quickly.
So you seem very well versed in the methods of getting downloads and converting. Were you your own marketing manager, or have you hired somebody that you were able to residually learn all this stuff from?
No, all those podcasts that I showed and reading. No, I'm not trained in marketing. I've read a lot, but I didn't have any marketing person. Just recently, within the past couple of months, I hired a PR firm. Just because I have these eight apps that I'm releasing, and it's a lot of work, you know, each app contacting the press and creating press releases and all that. So I have hired a PR firm.
Great presentation. That is a good job. Looks like you are only focusing on iOS, is that correct right now?
Yeah, that's correct right now.
And what is the barrier for you to enter to the Android market or other platform?
So I'm looking at Android now, and possibly other platforms. Kind of my thinking up to now has been just what I've heard from other app developers. I hear if you make $100 on Apple, you might make $10 on Android, and maybe $1 on Windows Mobile. So if that's true, and you're deciding, what am I going to do with my time? Am I going to create a new app, or am I going to port my app to Android? You know, where is the most value going to be? And so far, the choice has been to stick with iOS, though I recognize that Android, it already has a very large install base and is growing very quickly, so that is something that I'm seriously considering.
Patrick, if you don't mind saying, can you say who your PR firm is, and do they already have experience with mobile?
It's an agency down in Sacramento, and yeah, they've been around for about 3.5 years. I first saw them around the time that I was getting started, and kind of stayed in touch, so that's an agency.
This last one, by the way.
When you did the cross-referencing, did you coordinate the graphics and the colors?
What do you mean by cross-referencing?
Maybe I don't know what the exact term is. If you
The cross promotion?
Yeah, cross promotion. Did you coordinate the colors and the graphics?
Oh, between our two apps?
Yeah.
No, because each of our apps has its own look and feel. So, you know, within our app, we did something that looked like for our app. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Patrick. Great. Thank you to our sponsors. Thank you all for coming. We'll be here the fourth Monday of February, the date of which I don't remember, but 6 p.m., same place, same station, so I hope to see you then. Thanks a lot.